Hello, and welcome to this virtual service of worship here at College Hill Presbyterian Church in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I'm the Reverend Todd Freeman and have the honor of serving as the pastor of this community of faith. For this second Sunday of Advent on December 6th of 2020, and we are very glad that you have joined us. And as always, if you've received our email, you can print out a copy of today's bulletin with lots of good liturgy to follow along with. And also, the special Advent lighting this year is a devotional that includes poetry from Maya Angelou. So we find that particularly meaningful, especially during these tough times, with words of hope from Maya Angelou. With those words, then, let us now prepare our hearts and minds to worship God as we listen to this morning's prelude.
This morning's prelude is, and by some people's opinion, the number one Advent hymn of all time. It is truly an ancient hymn. The name of it is Savior of the Nations Come. It's at page 102 of our hymnal. This was written by Ambrose, the Bishop of Milan, in the 300s. And, you know, I've already talked sometimes about how important Martin Luther was to modern hymns. And Martin Luther actually took the text and took a plain chant from the same time and created the hymn that is in our hymnal today. And you may not recognize it because we don't do this one too much, but truly, this dates from the 300s. And the language was written by Ambrose at the time because there had been a schism in the church concerning the Arian heresy. And this hymn was written to define and to speak up for the true divinity of the Christ child. And I'd like to just read the very first verse. Savior of the nations, come. Virgin Son, make here your home. Marvel now, O heaven and earth, that the Lord chose such a birth.
Good morning, and welcome to you all. We gather this morning, the second Sunday in Advent, to light the candle of peace. Reading from Isaiah 40, verses 3 through 5. A voice cries out, "In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of God shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of God has spoken." I would like to share with you this morning a poem by Maya Angelou entitled Amazing Peace. Thunder rumbles in the mountain passes, and lightning rattles the eaves of our houses. Floodwaters await us in our avenues. Snow falls upon snow, falls upon snow to avalanche over unprotected villages. The sky slips low and gray and threatening. We question ourselves. What have we done to so affront nature? We worry, God. Are you there? Are you there, really? Does the covenant you made with us still hold? Into this climate of fear and apprehension, Christmas enters. Streaming lights of joy, ringing bells of hope, and singing carols of forgiveness high up in the bright air. The world is encouraged to come away from rancor, come the way of friendship. It is the glad season. Thunder ebbs to silence, and lightning sleeps quietly in the corner. Floodwaters recede into memory. Snow becomes a yielding cushion to aid us as we make our way to higher ground. Hope is born again in the faces of children. It rides on the shoulders of our aged as they walk into their sunsets. Hope spreads around the earth, brightening all things, even hate, which crouches breeding in dark corridors. In our joy, we think we hear a whisper. At first, it is too soft, then only half heard. We listen carefully as it gathers strength. We hear a sweetness. The word is peace. It is loud now. It is louder, louder than the explosion of bombs. We tremble at the sound. We are thrilled by its presence. It is what we have hungered for. Not just the absence of war, but true peace. A harmony of spirit, a comfort of courtesies, security for our beloveds and their beloveds. We clap hands and welcome the peace of Christmas. We beckon this good season to wait a while with us. We, Baptist and Buddhist, Methodist and Muslim, say, come, peace. Come and fill us and our world with your majesty. We, the Jew and the Jainist, the Catholic and the Confucian, implore you to stay a while with us so we may learn by your shimmering light how to look beyond complexion and see community. It is Christmas time, a halting of on this platform of peace, we can create a language to translate ourselves to ourselves and to each other. At this holy instant, we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ into the great religions of the world. We jubilate the precious advent of trust. We shout with glorious tongues at the coming of hope. All the earth's tribes loosen their voices to celebrate the promise of peace. We, angels and mortals, believers and non-believers, look heavenward and speak the word aloud. Peace. We look at our world and speak the word aloud. Peace. We look at each other, then into ourselves, and we say without shyness or apology or hesitation, "Peace, my brother. Peace, my sister. Peace, my soul." Alongside the candle of hope, this week we light a candle of peace in the midst of a war-torn, polarized world. Strife is everywhere, but God's peace, God's shalom, is more than just the absence of war, as Angelou insists. It's true peace, a harmony of spirit, a comfort of courtesies. Where do we most need this harmony today? Where in your personal life, in your community's life, in our planet's life? What would peace look like, and how are we being called to help make it? God of Shalom, we pray for our hearts, our homes, and our world so full of war and rumors of war. Give us the wisdom and courage to be peacemakers, to come the way of friendship. Show us the way to prepare for your coming, to make the rough places plain, to help create a lasting shalom in your world, a peace louder than the explosion of bombs. Come, Prince of Peace, come. Amen.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. God of peace, during this hectic season, break into our routines. Inform our vision. Equip us to hear and see you at work, in, and among us. We confess that we need to be more open to your ways of peace. Send your light to illumine our thinking and guide our actions. Prepare a way in our own lives and in the life of this congregation to receive the good news of Jesus Christ. And we pray for the courage needed to help prepare the way for others to hear that message. Hear now our silent personal prayers of reflection and confession. Hear now the assurance of pardon. May the Lord guide our way, strengthen us in all goodness, and make us abound in love for one another and for all. Peace before us, peace behind us, peace under our feet. Peace within us, peace over us. Let all around us be peace. The peace of Christ be with you.
Jesus, the Savior, did come forth.
Old Testament reading is Isaiah 40, verses 1 through 11. God's people are comforted. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I say, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers. The flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers. The flower fades. But the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear, says the cities of Judah. Here is your God. See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep.
The assigned lectionary gospel passage for this second Sunday of Advent comes from the Gospel of Mark, starting the very first chapter and the very first verse. And you will notice parallels with the Old Testament passage that was just read from Isaiah 40. Hear now for God's presence in our hearts, minds, and spirits. The beginning of the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, see, I am sending a messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make his paths straight. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, the one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. May God bless the reading and the hearing of this word. Amen. Last week, I mentioned that the first Sunday of Advent marks the beginning of a new liturgical church year. And we have entered into what is known as Year B in the lectionary, the second year in a three-year recurring and repeating cycle. And whereas the gospel readings for year A focus primarily on the Gospel of Matthew, this year will focus on the Gospel of Mark. And also, as I mentioned, it is believed that Mark is the first of the four gospels in the New Testament to have been written. And it is believed to have been written during or just after the disastrous Jewish revolt against Roman imperial occupation in Palestine, sometime between the years of 66 to 70 CE. Mark's world had been shaken to the core by Rome's vengeance in its response to the rebellion. For they destroyed the Jewish temple in Jerusalem, the very heart of Judaism. This catastrophic context, as we will see, has important similarities to the context to which the prophet Isaiah spoke the words that we heard in today's Old Testament reading from Isaiah 40. Now, the book of Isaiah was written, scholars believe, by three different prophets. And they believe so because the context of the entire book relates to situations before, during, and after what is known as the exile. Second Isaiah begins with what we heard today. And here's a bit of historical background, which, as I mentioned, has parallels with Mark's context and somewhat even with our own. A century before, the northern kingdom called Israel fell to the Assyrians, and many people were taken away to live in a foreign land, never to return. And many others became refugees who streamed to the southern kingdom known as Judah. Then the southern kingdom fell to the new superpower, the Babylonians. And again, some people were forced to live in exile in Babylon, while others were stuck in the ruins of post-apocalyptic Judah. Its capital, Jerusalem, had been devastated. In fact, the Babylonians destroyed the Jewish temple that was built by King Solomon, much as the Romans did about 600 years later in Mark's time after it had been rebuilt. Now, everything they once knew was basically gone. Those who were exiled wondered if they could ever worship like they used to in Jerusalem, and wondered if they would ever return home. So how does God respond? With comfort. God tells the prophet, "Comfort, oh comfort my people." The prophet proclaims a message of hope to the Jewish exiles in Babylon. And the heart of that message, yes, things may be terrible now, but take comfort, for there is a tomorrow, and God is still with us. Well, perhaps that is a message that we all can share with others in need and with each other during this Advent season this year. As we currently struggle through our own difficult and devastating times. For do we not also find ourselves in a kind of exile from our regular routines and a feeling of being disoriented and even dislocated, accompanied by distress, struggle, and for many, suffering and sorrow? Yes, things may be bad now in 2020, but take comfort. There is a tomorrow, and God has not left us. This is indeed the message the gospel writer Mark wanted to share as well. In fact, this is how he begins his gospel. The opening lines of prophecy are actually a combination of images and verses from Exodus, Isaiah, and Malachi. But Mark then immediately introduces John the Baptizer, who he sees as the fulfillment of the Old Testament Hebrew prophecies. Note, therefore, in Mark's gospel, there are no angelic visits to Mary or Joseph. No story of a visit between Mary and Elizabeth, John the Baptist's mother. No trip to Bethlehem. No baby Jesus. No shepherds out in their fields. No wise men following a star and bearing gifts. And no fleeing to Egypt to escape a paranoid King Herod. No, these elements of what are known as the birth narratives are only found in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, which were written using Mark's Gospel as a template more than a decade or so after Mark. So this indicates, along with the fact that the early letters of the Apostle Paul, which precede the Gospels and say nothing of Jesus' birth, indicate that these birth stories were not yet part of the developing Christian tradition. This has led most biblical scholars today to conclude that the birth narratives themselves were actually the invention and construction of later authors who sought to reflect the developing theological understanding of Jesus within the Christian movement of their time. In other words, the birth stories were written not as literal history. But to answer the post-resurrection question, where did this Jesus come from? And the answer, of course, from God in heaven. But alas, that's another story, and not one without its own share of intense controversy that I will address at another time. But let me go back now and offer a bit of an explanation of Mark's opening words. To better understand the crucial role that is played by John the Baptist by embodying the prophecy of Isaiah, it helps to know a bit about road construction in biblical times. In the ancient world, with some parallels to our own day and time, high government officials, especially kings, would send advanced teams on ahead of them to the cities that they planned to visit. And important information in those days was spread by town heralds, who would cry out the news in the public town square or marketplace. And they would also make whatever preparations were necessary for the impending visit of the dignitary. However, there was always one issue that was particularly problematic. One, in fact, that had to be dealt with before any important person would travel. And that was the condition of what passed for roadways thousands of years ago, for they were always in disrepair. And upon reflection, I guess that's not too unlike the constant state of the condition of roads here in Tulsa, which actually I'm glad are always under a state of repair. But now sometimes, all it took was to remove shrubs or boulders that had fallen onto the road. At other times, however, the disrepair was so extensive that entire new portions of a road had to be constructed before a king or official would even venture to travel. And not unlike modern-day road construction projects, people in ancient times would have to prepare for a new roadway by filling in valleys, by leveling hills, and making the pathways as straight, level, and smooth as possible. These methods of road construction were the basis of the imagery used by the prophet Isaiah. A voice cries out, "In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, every mountain and hill made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken." The gospel writer Mark announces that John the Baptizer, like messengers and heralds of old, appeared in the wilderness to prepare the way, not of some government official, but of the Lord, the coming Messiah. And John does this by preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, and announcing the coming of the one more powerful than he, one who would baptize with the Holy Spirit. So in essence, John proclaimed a message that encouraged folks to repent, which meant that the people should have a change of heart and mind and spirit, as well as a change in attitude and behavior. They were to do whatever was necessary to turn back to God and to return to following the ways of God. Now, that's an important message for us at any time during the year, but especially during this season of Advent as we prepare a way in our own hearts and minds and spirits for what it means that God is with us. Emmanuel. Over 60 years ago, biblical commentator William Barclay interpreted Isaiah's and John the Baptist's road construction analogy in the following and still very relevant way. Fill up the valleys of ignorance. Bring down the mountains and hills of prejudice and pride. And more recently, reflecting on the issues of economics and social status, the Reverend Grant Gallup suggests, fill up the valleys of poverty. Pull down the mountains of privilege, selfishness, and greed. And I know we could all come up with many more examples of valleys and hills that need to be dealt with in our own lives, in our family lives, in our neighborhoods, our city, our state, our nation, and even in the entire world. Both overt and unrecognized racism, for one, hyper-partisanship, for another. Whether in the days of exile in Babylon, in the aftermath of the destruction of the temple in Mark's time, or in the disturbing, disorienting, and unhealthy days that we face, let us take heart and share with others the message of old. Comfort, oh comfort my people. On this second Sunday of Advent, when we light the candle of peace, it is my sincere hope and prayer that each of our lives and the lives of all people will be meaningfully touched by the shalom of God's sacred presence with us. Amen.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of the day. God of peace, we pray for your peace on earth, for peace that is life-giving, for peace that is love-bearing, for peace that is true freedom, for peace that is purposeful, for peace that is prevailing. Loving God, deepen our desire for peace, restore our resolve for peace, increase our intent to work for peace. Amen.
Before our prayer, I want to share from the devotional book that we're using to light the Advent wreath and the poems of Maya Angelou, the practices that they suggest for this second Sunday in Advent when we light and lit the candle of peace. They suggest, light two candles, say a prayer, breathe in peace, breathe out peace. Challenge yourself to be a peacemaker today. Identify a strained relationship and take a concrete step toward reconciliation. Send a card, reach out, or call. Connect with someone who belongs to another religion and wish them the best wishes for the holidays that they celebrate, or in any case, for a happy and healthy new year. Get out into creation and visit the most peaceful spot that you know. Savor God's peace and watch for God's glory. And pick a day this week or part of the day for a silent, unplugged retreat. No screens or devices, no speaking, no problem solving, just pure, rejuvenating peace. Great suggestions. And at the beginning of the prayer, I want to share a short prayer by Steve Garness Holmes that he entitles, Prepare the Way. Let us pray. God, how shall we prepare your way? How might we announce your coming? How might we live to make your coming plain? How will we think, speak, and act this day? As a messenger of grace, so those who yearn may hope, and those who sit in darkness and the shadows of death may rejoice. How do you enable us to live this gospel? What path are you making in our hearts? How are you preparing your way in us? Let us see and hear and trust and follow. Loving and gracious God, on this particular Sunday when we emphasize peace, we pray that you will bring your peace into our hearts, minds, and spirits, the kind of peace that only you can bring. And with that peace, we pray that we will reach out to others who are also in need of peace, that we may indeed be known as peacemakers. And thank you for reminding us of your comfort through today's scripture passages, through the hymns and music, and through your very presence. We are in great need of comfort at this time. And we pray especially for those in need of healing and wholeness, some in our own congregation who've recently gone through illnesses, one through a surgery. So bring comfort to those in need and use each and every one of us to comfort your people. And we ask this in the name of our Lord, who we now pray together, saying, Our God who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Join with me now in the charge and benediction. Wherever you find yourself this week, go forth in a spirit of peace. We will journey through this season as caring, generous people, eager to live the good news and to share hope and peace with others. So wherever you find yourself this week, know that God goes before you to lead you in the way, that God goes behind you to encourage you, that God goes above you to bless you and beneath you to support you. God goes beside you to befriend you, and God goes within you to empower you to live your life to the glory of God, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, now and forevermore. Go in peace. Amen.
Today's postlude is a version of the hymn you just sang, Comfort Ye My People. And what I would like to tell you about this actually does have some more connectivity, as opposed to the Lutherans, to the Calvinists, because this was written by Louis Bourgeois, who traveled to Geneva to serve John Calvin in his church. And he was the music director. And a funny little story on this is that what they used in the church back then was called the Psalter. And that was a book that had psalms and hymns. And I guess people took their music really seriously back then, because when Louis got to Geneva, he started rearranging a few of these. And because of his rearrangement of some traditional hymns, they jailed him. And as any good pastor would do, John Calvin got him out of jail. Anyway, you all will know this, of course, as the very first movement from Handel's Messiah.